Hello everyone, we'll get it started. Hi, so my name is Raj.
Raj Shekhar, I work as a development analyst for Microsoft. So in this session, I kind of wanted to briefly cover what are all the most common strategies that are available today for client-side solutions, right? What do I mean by client-side solutions? So frequently in our web applications, we keep running into situations where we want to store bits of data on the client, and we want to use that for whatever reason, right? So
this session is about what are all the strategies, what are the techniques and technologies available with HTML5 that allow us to do this with the modern web. So the focus is on what's available in the modern web, right? So that sort of is what we look at. Why is this important? Why should we care about client-side storage? Then we start reviewing some of the options, cookies, DOM storage, IndexedDB. We'll try to spend a little bit of time about compatibility. It's always a concern. We'll talk about security a little bit, and we'll close out with some questions. So why should we talk about client-side storage? Why is this important? Connectivity is getting better and better, right? It's like if you pretty much live in cities and you don't travel a whole lot, it's actually possible today to be continuously connected all through your 24 hours, right? And that's great. But still, we haven't got to a point that it's not a concern anymore. Disconnected user experiences on the web is still something that's something that you're gonna keep encountering, right? Especially on mobile form factors, or even on laptops, or on phones, right? There will be situations where you don't have connectivity, and as web developers, what does that mean, right? So does that mean that our apps become completely inaccessible at those points? So those scenarios are becoming more and more important. There are places where you have intermittent connectivity, and then you want your app to be usable while there is some connectivity. Caching of information is important. For instance, there are various kinds of caching, right? But how about caching data itself? So your application is, maybe you're making an AJAX request and you're fetching some data from the server, and then you do something with that, right? Now, what if we could have that data persist and then use that, for the next time, even when there's no connectivity? In fact, I think Gmail kind of did this in a very nice way with their Google Gears thing plugin that they used to have, where your email would be available offline. So even if you didn't have connectivity, you could still check your email. Like you can go to mail.google.com and then mail.gmail.com, it would still work. So that kind of scenario, right? Your app is basically a web app, but you want it to work, provide a reasonable user experience when there is no connectivity. So there is a HTML5 specification called offline web applications. So there's a spec called offline web applications, which really complements all the stuff that we're going to look at today nicely. You might have heard of it as app cache. So the basic idea is, if you have a web app and you have all your resources, right? You have your CSS, JS, your HTML, markup. App cache is a spec that allows browsers to take that and cache it offline. So basically, you can visit the site even when you don't have connectivity. You can actually open your browser and go to example.com, and the site would still load even if there is no connectivity. Do you have a question?
Just a small clarification. The offline web application spec, or the app cache, is part of the actual HTML5 spec.
Correct.
It's not a separate spec. It's part of the HTML5 spec.
Correct. It is.
Just the clarification.
It is part of the... the HTML5 itself is a marketing term. There is, W3C does not version HTML anymore. So HTML
is... Still
sorry?
The WordPress version HTML5, the WordPress, they said that HTML5. So when it comes to the HTML5 specification itself, the app axles, I think section 6.
Oh, so you're saying it's part of the main spec?
Yes.
So, you know, all these technology talking about down storage and XDP really complements that very nicely. And then, of course, for Windows 8, if you're building desktop applications with HTML5, CSS, and JavaScript, then these things are probably have created applicability as well, because your app itself will run whether you have connectivity or not. So with that, I quickly want to cover what we all know about cookies. Has been traditionally the technology of choice when you want to do persistent storage on the client. The nice thing about cookies, of course, it works pretty much everywhere. So it's been around for a long time. It works on the desktop, mobile, everywhere. There are storage size limitations with cookies. So you can store up to 4K of information on the, if you want a persistent, you can store 4K of information on the client. cookies get transmitted with every single request. So, if you are, for every request, that HTTP request that hits the server, the cookies that have been created on the client get transmitted up and down. And this goes even for stuff like CSS and image files and so on, right? So even a CSS file getting requested, it goes up and comes back down. and there's not much of a programming model at all. So all you can do is store bits of string inside your cookies. Right? So if you want to have some structure in your data, then it's pretty much up to you, right? So you have to take your data and do, comma separated format, or you want to come up with your own format, or you want to do JSON serialization, whatever the case is, or XML. So you can do whatever the thing is, but ultimately the cookie just stores a string, and you have to do the parsing, cracking, and whatnot. but it works, right? It works. And there are, for example, there's a jQuery plugin that that really helps you deal with cookies in a very nice way. It provides a nicer programming API for the cookies. So that's something that with HTML5, one of the things that it brings for us as web devs is something called as DOM storage. So DOM storage is a HTML5 spec that provides simple persistent key value storage on the client, right? So the API couldn't get any simpler. So we look at a brief demo. So it's simply an object on a window object, right? So you can simply say window.session storage of key equals value, and you can fetch the data also like that. So there are two kinds of storage. There is session storage and local storage. So these are equivalent to session cookies and persistent cookies. So session storage is basically an object where whatever you put into it is available during that session across pages. Right? So if you, in a particular browser session, if you are on page A, you put some data there and you navigate to page B, you can get the data back. So throughout that session, the data is persisted. local storage is the counterpart where the information gets persisted across sessions. So the API is exactly the same. I mean, there are different objects, but the API is the same. whatever you put in local storage gets persisted on the file system itself, right? So even after system boot or you close the browser, open the browser, the data in the local storage is gonna get persisted. Yeah.
Okay, so this is not that.
Yeah.
The
is what? Sorry.
It's called web storage. The web storage.
It's called web storage. Okay.
Same thing. Everything is the same. It's just called web storage.
Okay. that's what this does. And some of the other aspects of this API is that this is scoped by domain. So whatever you store in session and local storage is available in that particular domain. So, what that means is example.com says local storage of e equals value. Packer.com cannot get that value from your local storage. So this is supported on IE from version 8 onwards. As opposed to cookies, you can store lots of data here. So Chrome and Firefox allow up to 5 megabytes, IE does up to 10 MB of data. One caveat with DOM storage and session storage is that you cannot iterate over it. The sense that you have to know what you've stored, right? So if you have stored 5 values, you can get those 5 values back. You cannot say, get all the values that have been stored in my DOM storage. You can't iterate over that. otherwise, this is a pretty nice solution. Sorry? The question is the 5 MB and the 10 MB limit, is it per domain? Yes, it is per domain.
It's by origin.
It's by origin. Maybe let me just show you what the API looks like. It's not much at all. So this is a little console that I use to quickly test out small pieces of script. So for instance, let's say I want to store some piece of data in my session storage.
you know, then I can do something like this. I can say, I guess I have to get it on my mouse. Alright, so I can do something like, you know, window dot session storage of, you know, some key equals some value. Right, so that's all. That's what the API looks like. Not much at all, right? And as soon as you do that, and I go ahead and hit Control Enter, and I just ran the script. Now, what I'll do is, obviously, I can get that data back. I can say print of. Alright, I can say print of session storage of who. And then you should see that data come on the right hand side here. So we're able to, you know, store it and retrieve it. So I'll just go ahead and refresh this page, you know, to simulate a page navigation. And then I'll go and put the control print, and you can see that the data is available here still. Right. So that data was persisted for this particular process session. Obviously, if I close this and open a new tab and do that, and now I'm running it, you see that there's nothing coming there on the right hand side, and obviously because it's a completely new session. The other alternative is local storage. So the only thing that changes is the object. So you know, I probably say local storage of who equals something, right? So and I'll go ahead and run this. Called who, and then we're able to get that data there. So what we should see is if I, you know, completely close the browser, I open a new instance, I go to the same site, I paste that, and when I run it, I still get the value, right? So here the data is very persisted across browser sessions, and this will get cleared when you clear the browser cache and so on. Right? Each browser has its own mechanism, so if you won't clear it, it can. So don't rely on that. So don't make really critical information in your DOM storage and your site is broken, it's not there. It's probably a bad idea, because when the browser is cleared, then it's gone. probably, let me show you, I was trying to see where this thing might make sense in a more real world case. So I put together a very simple example here. So this is basically an ASP.NET site. The server side stuff doesn't really matter. So I hit F5. So basically what I have here is a little form. You can see that I have done this before. How many times have we had cases where, you know, there will be this big complicated form on some site and the user keeps filling it, and then, you know, kaboom, something happens, you know, the system crashes and whatever I entered in my form is gone. Right? And then I have to do the whole process again from the first. Which of course is a very poor user experience, right? So what if we could, you know, slightly enhance that? So, you know, I fill this form, you know, I fill my address, I'm filling this text box here, and something happens, the browser is, you know, just crashes. I didn't get to hit my submit button, so which means it didn't go to the server. Now I hit the, you know, page again, and you know, the user would just be delighted to see that data is not gone, right? So in this case, all the information that I entered is still there, right? So this was not stored on the server because I never hit submit. So what exactly happened here? So I used DOM storage to implement this. So the actual code here doesn't matter. So what actually happens here is I set a set interval, and every 1 second I call a method here called saveForm in my form cache object. And in saveForm, what I do is I iterate through a list of form fields in my form. This can be more complicated. I mean, I just made a simple case. For example, you might use a CSS3 selector to select all my text fields and iterate through that maybe. And here all I do is I get the value, and then I call, you know, I have a small API for my DOM storage, where all I do is I simply store it in my local storage, right? So essentially what's happening here is every 1 second, a little piece of script walks through my form and saves everything to DOM storage. And when the page loads, so load form is getting called the first time, so that's here, form cache or load form. And here I simply walk through, you know, each of these elements, and I initialize my forms from that. So a very simple use case, but you know, something that can really provide a nice UX. So that very briefly was DOM storage. Yes.
You mentioned that these kind of storage have a key value kind of.
Correct.
The value has to be like very fundamental objects like strings or anything. Or can they be more complex objects?
Good question. Right. So the question was, so it's a key value storage. Can we store only strings, or can we store other kinds of things into the DOM service storage? You can store only strings. So the same thing applies. So if you want to store other kinds of objects, you can serialize it yourself. So for instance, if I want to store an object here. So let's say, you know, I have a person object, right? So person equals that, and name is this. So this is a, you know, it's not a regular string, right? And I want to store this in DOM storage, so I can say local storage of person equals json.stringify. So this JSON is a part of ECMAScript 5, and I can do that. And this gets saved inside the DOM storage, right? And so, you know, for example, I can say print this. So, you know, it basically converted my JavaScript object into a JSON string, and we've saved that. Obviously, I can I can get that back. So here I'll get rid of all this. I'll say var o equals, or maybe I'll say var p equals JSON dot parse. I'll do the inverse of that, of local storage of p. Okay. So in the former case I stringified, here I parsed, and then now I'm able to access that object like any regular object. I can say p.name, and you should see the name getting printed there. So yeah, that part still is the same. Which kind of nicely leads into our next topic, which is indexing, where you can store arbitrary objects in the database. So that was.
Can you check for a number of times that this should come?
Okay, like can it expire?
Yeah.
Okay, the question is, when you store the value inside the local storage in such storage, can you configure an expiry period after which the value will disappear? Yeah. No. So another probably related question could be, how do you remove stuff from the cache? I mean, from the local storage and the DOM session storage. One is, of course, the user goes and clears the cache, goes away. Or you can do delete of, like any other JavaScript object, you can say delete local storage of some particular key, and it goes away from the.
Do you have access to, like, when it was originally stored? How old is this?
Yeah.
I mean, all that you will probably have to manage in your data. Yeah. This is really as simple as it can get, key and value.
When it comes to deleting stuff, you have two methods. One is called remove item, which removes one particular thing in local storage. Or you have local storage, but the other way removes all the things in local storage.
Right.
So, deleting the local cache will delete the entire storage.
Correct. Yeah. The question was, does deleting the cache will clear the local storage cache as well? Yes, it does. The next thing I wanted to kind of talk about is IndexedDB, which is also a HTML5 spec, part of HTML5 suite. So IndexedDB is basically a persistent structured data store in the browser, right? So just like DOM storage and cookies, this is also scoped by origin. So whatever you store in a database in IndexedDB on the client is scoped by the domain in which it was stored. Each database is versioned, which can be an important thing. When you think about it, like, you know, so this is a database, which means it has a schema, right? So this database has n number of tables, and you store different kinds of things in these tables. And you might change your schema as you keep up, you know, as you keep enhancing your site. And users might visit your site at different points in time. So you have this whole mess that you have to deal with, right? So user A visits my site today, and I was on one particular version of my schema, and then I updated my site, user never visited that. And they might visit some future point in time. Now they have an older version on the client side, I have a newer piece of script. How do you manage the whole thing? So, you know, each database gets versioned. So when you create a database on your site, on your web application, you can associate a number with it, and then you can check for that. So when the site loads, you can check what is the version of the database on the client. And if it is different from the version that you expect, you can do the appropriate thing. You know, maybe you can take all the data, migrate to the new version, or whatever makes sense for your app, right? So that's briefly what IndexedDB is about. There was another specification which Google put together called WebSQL. So that, if you're using it today, then you know you should probably stop using it. W3C has deprecated that spec, so it's not the recommended way of doing things anymore. that was based on SQLite and various reasons we did not find consensus. IndexedDB is the W3C recommended way of doing client-side structured data storage, and all modern browsers support it. Yes.
Sorry. When it comes to, there's a small difference between deprecating the specification and it being impossible or not being maintained. Then when it comes to WebSQL, it's impossible. It's not deprecated, it's impossible, which means further work on it is not being done. Which effectively means the same thing, but there's an important distinction to be made. And also, when it comes to IndexedDB, Okta is working on it, but right now, it's more than that.
Right. I mean, this is also a draft status. It's not a final. IndexedDB is also in work in progress. In fact, this particular session has been done a couple of times before, and the demo that I put together, I had to every time, you know, the API is changing, so it's not being very pleasant. But hopefully, it'll get finalized. And but yeah, for WebSQL, don't use it. So IndexedDB, there are some important concepts that one needs to be aware of. So there is this idea of an object store. So in this picture, that all these little black boxes here, they are the equivalent of the tables that you have in relational databases, right? So you have SQL and Oracle and whatnot, you have tables there. So here the equivalent concept is a store, it's called an object store. The key difference is that relational databases, tables can have a number of columns. Here it's not, you know, that's not the way the data is stored, it's a key value store, right? So it's not columns and it's not multiple columns. You can obviously have multiple records. Each object store can have one or more indexes, that's why it's called an IndexedDB. So indexes, you know, basically, this is a way of quickly looking up data, right? So the values that you put into your index, into your object stores, can be, you know, for example, here, values can be objects too. So for instance, as the gentleman was asking earlier, DOM storage is just strings, you manage the serialization. IndexedDB, you can put arbitrary objects. So for example, my person object could have been, stored assets inside IndexedDB, and then I have multiple fields there, right? In my object, I have has a name property, has probably a contact ID property, and probably other fields. So I can create indexes on those, you know, sub fields of my object that is stored in my object store. and then you can do queries on top. Not exactly queries. You can or make API calls and, you know, use those indexes to fetch that information. Keys can be arrays, strings, dates, or numbers. Right, so those are the only values allowed for the keys inside the object store. Values can be array strings, dates, and numbers, and it can be an object as well. Right, so you can take a JavaScript object and dump it into the store. Another important concept with IndexedDB is transactions. So all I/O operations, reads, and writes that happen on the IndexedDB needs to happen in the scope of a transaction. Like you would expect from any database transaction, it's atomic, it's durable. So the asset properties. So these are some of the slightly different things that you have to be familiar with before we, you know, see what the programming model looks like. There is this notion of a request. Now, you know, with web applications, we're really talking about the front end, right? This is the user interface. And we really don't want to do anything in the user interface that causes the user experience to suffer because you're doing some long running operation. So as a general best practice, if you're doing something that's going to take a while to complete, do it in a background thread, right? Do it asynchronously. So if you're making a HTTP call, make sure that you do it in an asynchronous manner, right? So the same thing applies here. The IndexedDB API supports both the models. So it supports a synchronous model and an asynchronous model. So when you're working with the asynchronous model, what you get returned for a call which will complete at some point in the future is a request object, right? So let's say you want to insert a row. Maybe you want to fetch some information from the database, right? You're using what's known as a cursor. So in that case, you know, you make the call, you get the API itself would return a request object. You assign some event handlers on that, like when that thing completes, then I want this function to be invoked. If that call errors out, then I want this function to be invoked, and I do my recommending and so on. So that's the programming model for IndexedDB, and this is designed to make sure that your user interface remains responsive even when you're doing I/O calls. So these are I/O calls, right? So these can potentially take a long time to complete. It has to engage your hard drive and maybe write some stuff to the disk. So that's the extremely brief introduction to what IndexedDB is about. I'll just quickly show you a slightly non-trivial example of this. So I'll go ahead and launch Visual Studio here. So I've put together a little doodling app. So first, maybe I'll just show you what the app does. So this is basically, if you saw my previous session, this is exactly the same thing. So I can go ahead and draw stuff here. I can doodle, right? Now what I can do is I can close this app and then I can come back to it later, and whatever I doodle, continues to remain there, right? It doesn't go away. So what I've done in this particular app is, this is a canvas, the HTML5 canvas. Whatever I render, I take the coordinates and I save it into an index.db database. It just works. So there's a lot of code here, but I'll probably just show you the highlights. For instance, how do you actually create a database? So this little bit of code that you see here is an artifact of the fact that the spec is not final yet. So most of the browsers which implement index.db today implement that object, that API itself, with a vendor prefix. So the root object that you use to interface with index.db is something called as index.db. But that is the W3C name of that particular object. Since the spec itself is in flux, it's changing. Different browser vendors have used different prefixes. So for example, Firefox uses the prefix Moz for their version of the index.db implementation. WebKit, Chrome and Safari use WebKit. Microsoft uses MS. In IE, this is supported from IE 10 and up. So this is a little bit of sniffing to find out if it's supported, and if yes, I assign it to my index.db object. And then I do different things. So for example, just to give you a flavor of what the asynchronous API call looks like, I've written a little wrapper here that probably confuses things a little bit, or otherwise the code looks like something like this. So I can say window.indexdb.open, and I'll say db1, and I'll say my schema version is that. Then I can say request.onSuccess is that, do something in response to that. Request.onError, you can do something in response to that. And then you'll get mandated a reference to the database itself. So for example, I can go ahead and have my database variable there, and I write code like this, dot result, and then I get my database object. So this is what a typical asynchronous call looks like in index.db. So here I'm opening the database, right? And so in this case, if the database is not available, it'll get created, or if it's already available, it'll get opened. And then when that asynchronous IO operation completes, my onSuccess handler will get called, and my event objects target.result will have a reference to the database, and then and then the API continues from there. So with that DB object, I can create object stores, and so on. So that's one of the things that has slightly changed. So how that works is, in your request object, you need to handle an event called onUpgrade needed, where you are expected to create the schema of your database. So basically, this doRequest was just a helper routine that I wrote. It really doesn't matter what it does, but interpret this call as index.db.open, and then it passes the name and the version as the parameters to open. In case the version of the database in the client is different from the number that I pass here, then this particular callback will get invoked on upgrade needed. So request.onSuccess, request.onError, so you need one more call, request.onUpgrade needed, where you have to go and create your schema. So this is what the call to that looks like. So you say db dot create object store, and you pass the name of the object store. and probably I won't spend too much time on the details. There is a concept of a key path in object stores. So when you create an object store, how do you want the data indexed by default, right? So for example, if I'm storing person objects into my object store, my data model itself has a unique identifier for every element inside my object store, right? So typically, in a typical line of business kind of app, right? So maybe you have purchase orders, and you have a database on the server, right? Which is a full-fledged relational database. And you have some subset of that you want to store on the client for whatever reason. So you want to use the same identifier on the server and on the client, right? So which means that your data includes the unique ID. In that case, you can tell index.db that, hey, listen, my data has the unique ID for every row in this object store, and this is the path to that. So for instance, I can this can be something like purchase, or can be something like PO ID, right? Then what basically happens is, for every object that you store inside my object store, it will look at the property called POID of the data inside that to get the unique value for that particular entity. I know that probably didn't make a whole lot of sense. You know, I would encourage you to look at the spec and figure out the actual API itself. It's not that hard. In fact, you can actually read the spec itself. You know, it's not that scary as specs usually tend to be. The IndexedDB spec is fairly approachable. So that's where I'm creating the tables, the equivalent the object stores. How does code that fetches data look like? Yeah.
Can you share DB between domain?
Okay. The question is, can you share database between domains? No, you cannot.
That includes subdomains.
Excellent question. The question was, does that include subdomains? I'll come back to that. I've covered that in the security concerns aspect. In fact, we're kind of running out of time. So I'll put this up on my blog maybe. So if you want to look at this code in more detail, you can do that. So that was kind of an example of how you might store data and you know, slightly non-trivial, right? And as far as size limits are concerned, I'm not 100%, maybe some of you might know. Firefox, I think, has a limit of 50 MB by default of data that you can store in the IndexedDB. And you can still exceed after that, but typically when you exceed, some kind of UI pops up and you'll see a message that says, Firefox, if this site is trying to access more data than 50 MB, do you want to allow it? If you allow it, they get it. Other browsers, I'm not sure what the limits are.
Can you use your IndexedDB in developer toolbar?
Sorry?
Can you use your IndexedDB data in the
developer toolbar? The question is, can you view the IndexedDBs that you've created in different domains in the developer toolbar? Given on the browser, I think Chrome does show you that. So in the Chrome debugging tools, it does show, there's a database tab where you can go and see what IndexedDBs have you created. I haven't seen this in IE yet. I think Firefox, I don't know. To check that out.
And does it have the same caching concerns if you remove the local cache and IndexedDB?
Good question. Do the same caching concerns apply? Yes, they do. So if you go and clear your cache, your IndexedDB is blown away as well. Alright. Two quick things. What about compatibility? So there are a bunch of polyfills available for DOM storage. I've seen that. So if you go to bit.ly/polyfills, that's a GitHub page where the folks who are maintaining Modernizer library are. List of polyfills. I've seen some for DOM storage, I've not seen anything for IndexedDB yet. Maybe somebody will come up with one. Amplify.js is a JavaScript library which is a layer of abstraction built on top of all the possible ways that you can do client side storage. So it has its own API. So Amplify Store has its own API. So you say amplify.store of key from a value and so on. But they kind of use whatever is available. So it will work on, there's a good chance that it will work on older browsers also, because they take care of the backward compatibility piece. But then it's not a W3C spec. It's a separate library that somebody maintains and they have their own API. And there are other alternatives as well. I've just picked one of the popular ones. What are some of the security concerns? So DOM storage and IndexedDB, as I was mentioning earlier, are scoped by origin. As the gentleman pointed out, what about subdomains? So that is something that you have to worry about. So you will be able to access across subdomains. So in case you are on a common site, right? Say like some common hosting site, free hosting site, where you have your site and other people have the same domain, and you are just differentiated by subdomains, then you might have to think about this, how this thing works out. Typically, in general, don't store sensitive information. Storing a credit card in a DOM storage or IndexedDB is probably a bad idea. Be careful when you're including third-party scripts. They will have access to what you have access to. So if you are storing sensitive information, make sure that you've vetted the code to make sure that they're not doing anything funny with your data. Be careful when storing personally identifiable information. Typically, there are you might want to engage your lawyers and make sure that you're not doing something that will end up in a lawsuit. So that's probably not security, that's privacy. But still, that's something that you might want to think about. So that's about it. So this is what we looked at. We looked at what are all the options that are available for the modern web, DOM storage and index database. We looked at some security concerns. Those are some resources here. The IE10 dev guide talks about the support for IndexedDB in that URL and the support for IndexedDB in IE10. The Mozilla documentation is really good, really high quality documentation that you can really get a hang of the API itself. And this is a good time to learn the API. Like that demo that I was telling you about, one of the things that was truly horrible to work with was the cursor syntax. So once you store the information in the database, to fetch the data back was a very strange API that we had to work with earlier. Now it's much nicer. So this is a good time to go and look at the IndexedDB spec. IE Test Drive has a pretty decent demo there, which it's like a cookbook application where you can store recipes in the client and it will work even if you're offline. So if you want to see what that code looks like on a potentially real world site, you can go take a look at that. And the spec itself is of course the ultimate resource, the authoritative resource, and it's a very approachable document, as I was saying earlier, you can copy and read. So you can get in touch with me through one of those means. If you have questions, I can take them.
What is the support for mobile
phones? What are the support for mobile phones? So good question. You know what? I'm not very sure about that. But I think does anybody know?
There's
no support. Okay. So.
No, actually, when it comes to local storage, software storage, it's available. Supported across pretty much all smartphone browsers. When it comes to IndexedDB, right now, there's
long storage.
It's called web storage. Long storage was the original name my phone is available.
So, yeah, IndexedDB is probably going to take a while.
Store the
running to web cache,
right? Browser cache. Is there any technology
that can
save the
data out
of browser cache
for
them?
Yeah, so that's again a common question that folks ask. Like, what do we store in web storage or
IndexedDB?
Can you access it across browsers? You cannot. I mean, at this point in time, there's nothing like that. So there's simply no good solution for that. As in, of course, you can put it on the server, but in the client, there's nothing like that.
Does like the cross origin, the resource sharing engines come up now? The cross origin spec. Does that have something to do with something similar, like where you can share something like good storage may not be this? Is there something similar to that?
As far as cores is concerned, that works as long as the two domains in question have an agreed upon protocol, right?
Yeah.
So if that is there, that exists, then you can definitely share data. Each domain would have access to its own data. You can of course use cores to.
Communicate between them.
What are the performance implications of this? What are data sent to the server and what is the data? Both of what we saw today are completely local. Nothing gets to the server.
The cookie information is passed to the server.
Right. Vis-a-vis cookies, nothing gets sent to the server at all. So it's completely, and you get to choose. If you want to take some data and send it in, that's completely up to you. The browser doesn't do that. The question was what gets sent to the server. Cookies get sent to the request. It doesn't have a dominant IndexedDB as well. Yeah.
How the security concern, like the security for this country, that if we are using cookies for the non-transactional data, we have to specify our web page using some message box or that kind of thing that we are using cookies for this and this thing. So what is similar constraint for the web storage?
What is the, I don't understand, what, you have to show a message box.
I don't know if there are any similar things about
what DOM storage. Chances are that there are cookies there for DOM storage in IndexedDB as well. If you're storing any, again, personally identifiable information, I'm pretty sure that you have to let the user know, get into it, click an ID button.
Pretty much for images or something you are offline application.
Right.
All the examples you want to store data as well.
Yes.
What is store images?
Right, good question. So the question is, what if we want to store non-string data or JavaScript objects? So IndexedDB allows you to store array strings, dates, numbers, and JavaScript objects, but that still doesn't include binary data. there is no good solution. So if you want to do that today, then you probably have to serialize it somehow. Get base64 encode your image and store that as a string, get it back. But the good thing is now stuff like your image tag, your CSS3 rules, they all support
URL.
Yes. So you are able to specify an image as a base64 encoded string, So you could work with that, but it's not a very nice scenario.
Yeah. One more thing, just to add that when it comes to sharing between domains, when it comes to the per origin policy or our specifications, I slightly disagree with what was said earlier in the sense that, for example, subdomains are considered as different origins. So abc.something.com and xyz.something.com will be treated by the browser as different origins. So over there, find a video with like for abc as well as for xyz. Whereas subdirectories, those will be considered the same origin. So example.com/abc and example.com/xyz, those will be treated as the same origin. So over there, the cross directories will be one. So if you have any kind of web storage, like three web hosts, which gives you an account based on like a different directory, then don't use web storage. But if they give you like some subdomain, then it's fine.
So just to add to what you said, so cookies, you have actually wildcard cookies, which like you start on xyz.com. This is a question, I'm not sure. So is there any way that as a developer, if I have complete control over my infrastructure, like what I say to run there, so can I actually set web storage or not, so whatever, at start on xyz.com? So does this spec actually work for something like this?
You know, that means what you just said, then the abc.example.com and example.com will have indexing those So that means my subdomain will not actually have access to, like, for example, example.com and www.example.com will not have access to each other. But it can't seem to
I mean, I don't know, that's something that I've been, that's something I've been reading up last couple of days, and that's what I saw.
I know earlier when you had to subdomain, you could do that hack is like document.domain equal to document.domain, so given that you should do subdomain accesses.
Right. I mean, probably I'll have to go and check that up again, but this is what my understanding was.
Especially for the
Yes, so everything
is. Is there any more questions? Otherwise, it's been a long day, we probably want to go take off. Alright, thank you.